Alrighty, everyone. Welcome back. I hope you had a nice, refreshing break. Moving on to the next block of two talks, we have got someone coming up whom, if you have ever sort of created a pull request, it is quite likely that this fine gentleman has crossed your way, either merging your pull request or adding comments to it. And today he's here, so if you want to complain why he added too many comments or didn't watch your pull request, here's your chance. But at least please wait until after his talk. But today he's actually here to talk to us about sandboxing in Nix. So please give a warm welcome and a small applause for Jörg MiG92.
Hi there, I'm Jörg Thalm, as you already heard, and for those who don't know, I currently do a PhD in the University of Edinburgh, this is here in Scotland, and I do systems research there, so I crash software for science, and then I build tools in order to reproduce those and understand those failures, which is also a little bit related to what I'm going to talk about today. I'm Nix packages maintainer since 2 years, and in the Nix community, as you already heard, I review and merge pull requests. And to do that, I built a little tool called Nix Review that automates some of these tasks. You can check it out if you're also a Nix package maintainer or also just a contributor. What I also did is together with some other folks rejuvenate this wiki we had before. And you can check out on NixOS Wiki, you can also contribute to that to improve the documentation. And my latest pet project is this thing called Nix User Repository. So if you heard of this, of the Arch equivalent, it's contributed by users, so there's no central instance that merges pull requests, but instead it's like a meta repository, and every user there has its own namespace where they can put their own packages in, and so each user has their own repository, and then we have one big repository that aggregates those. And everything is automated, so you can also check out that. But let's get back to the actual topic of my talk. If you happen to be a contributor in Nix packages, you might have seen this form that you have to fill out. And one big question mark people sometimes have is, what does this first point here mean? And this is what we will talk about. So I explain what this build box is and why we need it, how it's set up, and how it is implemented in at least Linux, and what you can do if it does not work and if it breaks the builds. So for that, I built two tools, one which allows you to add breakpoints to your build. So instead of removing all the build artifacts that came up during the build, it lets you connect to that sandbox, and then you can interact it with the build. And then I also started working on building wrapper around a tool called SysDig that allows you to inspect the system calls that have been issued in the build, and then we can build some nice tooling around that, that it can point you to stuff that might cause build impurities, for example. And the overall goal of this talk is to understand and improve the documentation on sandboxes. So we are, so in order that everyone can check the sandbox and also know what they have checked here. So why do we need this sandbox actually? So we have our Nix expression language that creates this derivation, and it describes nicely what should go into a build. And then we have this Nix build sandbox that actually enforces that the build does not exceed these this dependency description. So to give you an example, let's say we have some guy called Bob, and he's on Ubuntu, and he has no sandbox yet enabled, and he wants to package NetData++, which is just an imaginary pack, C++ 20 monitoring dashboard, and he creates a package for that, and then he opens a pull request on X packages to add this package. Then we have a maintainer, and Alice, and she has a sandbox enabled, which every X package maintainer should do. And while building the package, she noticed that the build fails, and she complains that Bob forgot to add the boost library in order to build the package. And Bob wonders, it was working fine on my machine, why it's now failing on your machine. So what had happened here? So if you look into this imaginary package, we see that there's a CMake build system, and this has the property that it also looks in different location to find its dependencies. And there it also found that boost that this was installed by Bob manually at some point. So the build went through without any complaints. And a build sandbox would have prevented that because a build sandbox enforces that the build can only access certain files. It also do the same thing for network. For example, if you have this dashboard and it has some JavaScript that is used in the website, then there's a chance that it will call npm install at some point to build these JavaScript files, because this is how this is usually done these days. And this also sometimes went unnoticed because it's somewhere in the background in the depth of the build system, so it's not easy to detect. And a build sandbox also prevents that because it disallows any network access. So we can, except for a certain build type, which is called fixed input derivation, where we allow network access. And lastly, one thing which might be not obvious on the first view, it also helps us when we have CI builds and we have a big machines and we want to run many builds in parallel, then it can also help us to isolate different builds between each other. For example, if you have, if NetData also has some tests that are built as part of the build system, it might want to bind a TCP port. And if you have a different package that does the same, then both would conflict with each other. But thanks to this build sandbox, we can run both in parallel, and they don't conflict on resources. So the sandbox here allows us to isolate builds against each other.
Excuse me.
Yeah. Okay. At some point, I also have a demo, so I might need to switch back. Good. So, okay. Yeah. So now that I talked about why we want to have these build sandboxing, how can we actually enable that? So if you happen to be on XOS, and you also have the latest release or higher, then you don't have to do anything because it's enabled, say, it's 18.09 by default. If you're on an older version or you want to make sure, you can also set it in your configuration.nix by using that option as presented here. On non-NixOS systems, at least on Linux, you can, if you have a multi-user installation, so you have a Nix daemon running on your machine, so you can put this one line into your configuration and restart the Nix daemon afterwards. If you don't have a multi-user install, then you cannot use that. So now, I hope that everyone here can enable the checkbox for the next pull request. So how does this work? What does the sandbox do then under the hood, at least on Linux? There's also a macOS variant, but I am not familiar, and I also think it's not enabled or it's not working probably at the moment. So all this is implemented in this one file, basically. If you're familiar with C++, you can read it. It also has comments if you're not so familiar with C++, but I will also go into all of the details. And it unifies our build environments to make sure that we have all the same problems and can solve them together. And the APIs it uses are not very novel. It's some that are well known and also used in other projects, like most of the containers. And there are several components to that. So one, we have a change root. So this is a own file system tree where the sandbox can do the changes and only have a subset of the file system visible. Then we have namespaces to limit what processes within a build can see and access. Then we also have seccomp, which can further restrict some system calls you can do. If you have heard about, if you have worked a little bit with containers, you might also have heard about C groups, and those limits what, how much CPU or how much memory a process can use, and but they are not used yet in Nix itself. So let's go to the first component. You have this change root. So here you have your build host, and in this build host you have your build, and there's this change root, and in this change root. There is a subset of files, or it's own little temporary directory that is created, and then you have the build directory where the source code is, and source file where the variables are. Then you have a minimal set of files, so just enough so you can build most of the software, but not too many that you have some files that you might not found on any system. Then you have the build closure. So these are the dependencies that you have described in your build. And these get byte-mounted from the host system into this change root. I also have the demo for that. So now I show you how it looks inside the hello package if you build it, and what the build process sees during the execution. So now in this directory is everything what a Nix what the package sees when it is built with Nix and sandboxing enabled. So we have it's also found on our system bin, and there's this little shell from BusyBox there that is statically built. Then, as I've told previously, that we have. We have the source code of the project. Then we have this special file system called dev. So here you have all device nodes. And they are also less than usually available. So just some stuff like KVM, which you need to run virtualization, and then also the standard stuff like def null and so on. Then you have a minimal etc. So you just have some configuration for users that are available in the build sandbox, like root and the Nix build user. And you also have local hosts in etc hosts. And yeah, then the beefy part is here this Nix store that is a subset of the of what have been described in the build. And then yeah, proc is also something which can be found on any Linux. So you have here all the processes, but only the processes that are in the sandbox itself. No processes that are also on the system. Okay, and then temp, which is not so interesting. So now you have got a complete picture of what you have available in a Nix sandbox. And I want to progress to these namespaces. So there, this is a modular framework in the Linux operating system. So you can mix and match and use some of the namespaces, but yeah, so you can build your own little containers or sandboxes in a flexible way. So you have a network namespace, and in Nix, there's no networking allowed for most derivations. So you only have a so-called loopback device. So you can only do networking with yourself, and this is private. Then you have the same thing for Unix sockets. So for example, Nix daemon also has a socket, and But here we only see sockets that have been created during the build, the same for shared memory. Then one also important thing is host names, because many build systems also like to put their host name where they were built into the build, and this is something we want to unify. And lastly, we have a user namespace. And here in this namespace, in this build sandbox, we only have a single user. So no other users are allowed, or they are mapped to the nobody user. So every builder or yeah, on the host, you usually have these Nix build users from one to some number. And within this container, or within the sandbox, they all are called Nix build, and they have the UID 1000. And this is done using this user namespace. And then there are some other things like mount namespaces, so you don't see mounts from the host, and you also don't see processes that are running outside, not in the sandbox itself. Yeah, then there's also seccomp, but just for completeness, this is a system call filter. It's more used in containers, but here, since we already have a very restrictive user running there, so it's unprivileged. There's no user running there. We don't have much to do. So it only forbids to set up, also to create setuid binaries, and we also forbid access controllers because we cannot support those consistently across file systems. So the conclusion, the build sandbox is strict in what it allows, and it sometimes also diverges from the normal user environment, so you will see things working on your own system which might not work in a build sandbox, and this is where sometimes problems arise, so we should provide some additional tooling for users to inspect and understand the build sandbox better. And to give you information, motivation for that, last year we had this talk on incremental package builds, and if you have derivations like Firefox, they take quite a long time to build. But what do we do if this build fails? So the moment, the current, I would call it a feedback loop, is we have a build, and it might succeed, then we are lucky. If it fails, then the user has to fix it. So you might, if you don't understand what the actual cause for the failure is, then you have to add some debug instructions and restart the build. But you will know that your debug instruction will not fix the build, so you have to do that several times. So can we do better than that? So my proposal is to just give the user some shell so they can look into the build or build directory, and then they can hack whatever commands they want to add, and then so adding those over build cycles are becoming unnecessary. Therefore, what I have built is something called a breakpoint hook. So you can add, this is like a normal package, you can add it to your built-in ports or native built-in ports here. And what it does basically is it registers a failure hook in our builder. And when the build crashes, instead of Nix stopping the build and removing all the build outputs that have been created so far, it just halts. It just stays in the environment and sleeps forever. And what it allows us, and what it also do, it prints out a command that one can use to attach to the sandbox. And this is what I represent now. So we have here this hello package, and I modified it a little bit. I added this breakpoint hook, and I also made sure that it will fail. So I have here this false command, and it will return one on exit, and then it will make our build fail fast. So I will now make the build fail. So and instead of stopping, it will now notice that it stopped in a certain phase, and it will also output a command that we can use to attach. And this is a little tool that I created for debugging containers, but it turns out also to be nice for Nix. So you need to run it with root. And you have seen this previously, where I've shown you the shell where it was in the build sandbox, and also we are now in the same. So if you run htop, we see there's a sleep that is making the build stop. Then we have the build itself. Then we have our shell that is currently attached to that. And now we can, if we have a bug or something, we can actually fix stuff. So, like, I don't know, maybe changing something in the build system also, or can also repeat some commands for that. So there are two phases, actually. So there are two modes. So first you get your own system attached to that sandbox, but you still have the files from your system. So you still have tools that are usually not present in the Hello build, for example. You have Vim or so. But then you can actually call center exec, and that will go fully into the container. So now you can go again into build. Should also, this shell is a little bit less powerful because it has no read line on completion and so on. So that's why I have two modes, because it's the shell that is actually used during the build. And now also the configure works as expected. So back to the presentation. How does it work? So we have here our Nix build sandbox, and there's a builder that tries to build the Hello package. And what my tool do here, called center, is it creates something which you can think of it as a nested namespace. So it's like a sandbox in a sandbox. And this sandbox has access to the build environment and can interact with the files there and so on and see the processes that the sandbox sees and so on. But it also can access the build host. And this is realized via a fuse file system that is implemented under the hood. And this gives you access to more tools. So usually you have all your tools that you usually want to have, like a proper shell or strace available, but you don't have that in the sandbox. So with Fuse, you can get access to these. And if you also work with containers regularly, then you can also check out the project here. There's also a demo video. Okay. So. Next thing. So now we have an interactive shell in our build sandbox and can fix builds hopefully faster. We can also do something different, because most of these kind of bugs are somehow related with the environment. Because usually the developer of the software has tested this on their machine, and usually it's somehow something missing in the environment. Every process has to interact with the operating system somehow, so it will issue system calls in order to open files or whatever. And what we can do is we can get all these system files, system calls, and save them in a trace. And there's a tool for that from the container community, and it's called Sysdig. And this you can think of is feels like a TCP dump, so that you can save trace files, you can filter on system calls, like you can restrict that you only want to see system calls that are related to opening a certain file or something. So when we record these or failing builds, we can replay them, and then we can also add some heuristics, because usually builds fail for the same reason or similar reasons, so you can give the user better hints what to do there. And to use this stick, all you need to do is there's this module that you can enable, and then you just switch, and also you need to reboot, because it will also have this kernel module that needs to be loaded. So what I do is just write a little wrapper around this stick, so it filters properly the stuff that happens inside the build box. So it's called Sysdig. And I have some plans for that. So at the moment, it just records the builds. And then you can use the Sysdig infrastructure to filter what happens during a build. But on the roadmap, I also have some ideas, like, for example, if you have a package that tries to reach the network, you will see system calls that are related to networks. So usually it starts with some DNS that are resolved, and you can easily think of some little programs that you can write. So even if you're not so much into system programming, you can still do something useful. I still have a demo for that. So I have a slightly different package that I modified for that. Wrong directory. So all I did is just removing a dependency, in this case the PyTest runner, and then Python will complain that this is not available. But first, I need to go back, start the recording, so this will record the system calls, specifically for the package. Then I can now try to actually build the package. So this fails quickly because there's a dependency missing. In this case, it's pretty obvious, but you can easily imagine that there are some cases where it's not so easy. So we can now stop the recording. It created a scap file. So this is all the system calls that have been issued during the build. And then you can replay. So there's, for example, this example here, it traces all system calls that have been directed towards port 53, which is the DNS port. And it also restricts the system calls to CentOS, so you can get all the DNS requests. And here we see that it tried to reach out for pypy.org because it wanted to download this additional package, which wasn't there. Some other examples. Often it's useful because people like to suppress error output, but sometimes it's usually useful to have that error output. So we can just use some little programs that are also part of Sysdig to just get all the outputs that have been written to standard error. And this is pretty useful because it's way less output than the previous build output. And we can quickly see what might go wrong here. And yeah, you can, if you have some files that tries, for example, to open certain files that are not available, like in etc or so, then you can also filter for that. So, yeah, to summarize my talk, what we've learned today is how this sandbox works itself and what we can do if it does not work as expected. I've presented some two tools, one which allows you to make breakpoints in your build, and the other one which record and replay system calls. I have the source code of both of them here. Stender I just today merged also into Nix packages, unstable. I might also backport this to the latest release. And for Nix Sysdig, I still, it's already useful, as you have seen, but it's not adding too much to Sysdig itself. So I want to add some small programs that do more useful stuff. Okay, so that's all for my talk, and I would be now open for questions from your side.
Thank you. Questions? Ah, perfect. Ideally the ones that have actual question marks at the end of the sentence.
So you mentioned at the start that you have to have a multi-user installation in order to use the sandboxes. Do the daemons have to be running as root, or is it possible to run the daemon as an unprivileged user and use user namespaces to do everything that the sandbox needs?
So for setting up the sandbox, it would be actually possible to implement that without root. So LXC, which is also a container, does it actually. And because we don't need any stuff like network interfaces, it's all possible without root. But I think there are some other cases where root is required. For example, if you have the Nixtor, okay, maybe if Nixtor is also, yeah. I think you can actually implement the sandbox without root, but it's not supported so far. It should work? Okay, then it's incorrect what I said.
So you mentioned that the sysdig requires a kernel module to be loaded, and I just checked they have a beta support for eBPF. Have you tried that? Like not loading the module and using in kernel eBPF engine?
Yeah, then the question is if you also want to do that with. So the question was, yeah, we heard the question. If you don't have root, you might have problems with getting. So the kernel might not allow you to actually record the system calls of the builder if they're running as different users than yours. So I think this BPF stuff only works maybe for processes where you're the parent of. So it might become. I think the kernel approach is still probably required in most cases.
Next question. Anyone? Coming.
The tools and especially the breakpointing stuff, does it require the sandbox or can you do it in non-sandbox build as well if you want to debug stuff in the middle of your build?
Yeah, you can also do that without a sandbox and it's still useful in some way because it still reads certain properties from the process and establishes this try to clone the same environment. So during the development, it also happens that I've accidentally attached to the wrong process, and it still works. So it's transparent in that way.
All right, maybe one more.
Do I get the same environment in the sandbox like in Nixshell? Because you invoked configure, can I also invoke configure phase, for instance?
Yes, so it reads the environment variables that are set by the builder and then, yeah.
Okay, same thing. Thanks.
All right, okay, and thank you very much for your wonderful talk. Another round of applause, please. Thank you.